Hi, this is Justin Colletti of Sonic Scoop, and we're back for another installment in our three-part series on best practices for the home studio. We are at the home studio of one Mr. Bob Mallory, a great producer-engineer, longtime engineer at Avatar Studios, where he worked with artists like Bruno Mars, Fallout Boy, Kings of Leon, Paul McCartney, and a whole bunch more. He's now working regularly with Paste Magazine, doing a lot of their kind of live band performances. And he also mixes quite a bit here at his own home studio. Bob is going to give us some tips on what's worked for him in his own home studio and what he'd recommend to people who are just getting started with their own home studio. This time, we are talking about microphones and mic techniques for the home studio. Hopefully, we'll get some decent insights here. Bob, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
All right. Good to see you. So, a couple quick questions. If you're only going to have, say, one or two mics in the studio, what would you recommend for people, and what did you wind up getting for yourself?
One of my first mics, everybody starts with the 57.
Sure.
Eventually, I wanted to step it up. I like the SM7. I think that it sounds good on different sources, guitar amps, vocals. I love it on vocals. You can't go wrong with it.
Sure.
If I had to have, like, one inexpensive microphone, I would take the SM7 and not think about it again.
Right, cool. But I know that's not all that you have here. I think you have some condensers. Can you tell us about the rest of your kind of limited home studio mic setup?
Yeah, I just have a few. I have a pair of Neumann TLM-103s. I find they're just useful on, you know, just about anything. Some of my other favorite mics are coming out of Massachusetts from this guy, Michael Jolie.
Oh, sure.
He started OctavaModShop.com, and he's been modding Octava mics. He took a mic that I bought for $30 from a friend and, you know, made it sound like 10 times as good.
Right,
100 times as good. So I've been using some of his mics. He takes MXLs, Rhodes, other cheap mics, and mods them.
Right, so these are mics that if you could start out buying a fairly cheap mic like a Rhode or an MXL or an Octava, and if you get bored with it, you can send it over to him too to work on, right?
The Rhode NT5s are probably some of the cheapest matched stereo pairs that you can buy, small diaphragm condenser mic, and he mods them. So you could start out there, eventually have him mod them. They sound a lot better. I think that's a good place to go.
It's such a cool approach, and not a lot of people think about that. You can get a set of like decent $300 microphones, rock with that for a while, and then when you're ready to upgrade, instead of buying a $1,500 or $2,000 pair of microphones, you can kind of get them modded for another few $100 and maybe get closer to that world of high-end mics.
Right, yeah. Right. And I know there are some kits online one can buy to mod your own mics. Yeah. So if you're handy with a soldering iron, that's a path you want to go down, you have the extra time, you're not worried about maybe messing up your mic.
Well, we're a couple audio nerds. I don't think this is going to be for everybody who's watching right now. So if we had to go with stuff that's right off the shelf, give me, you know, a couple of options. What would you steer people towards? Say that they want one nice condenser mic, one nice dynamic mic. What would you recommend?
The TLM-103 by Neumann. That was the first fancy condenser that I bought. I've stuck with it over the years. I take it with me.
Yeah.
The studios are on location. I think that's a great condenser. You can probably mention a few other $1,000 range mics.
Sure.
But that's where that falls. I like it.
Yeah, I think that's a great mic. And actually, for people who want to hear that TLM-103 compared to several other mics, we have some B&H video series mic roundups where I think we compare the TLM-103 to a few other mics in that price range.
Oh, cool.
And we've got one where they can compare that short SM7B you were talking about to a whole bunch of other nice dynamic mics in that price range. But for some really quick comparisons, maybe we can do some guitar on a nice small diaphragm condenser compared to like a short SM57 that a lot of people are used to. And maybe we'll do a vocal comparison. Maybe I'll talk a little bit. We'll hear that Neumann TLM-103 compared to a short SM7.
Cool.
This is the sound of the Neumann TLM-103 in a treated room. This is the sound of the Shure SM7B in a treated room. We have the top boost engaged and the low cut filter. All right, so that was that Neumann TLM-103, Shure SM7 on voice, and SE Electronics RN17, pretty new one. I think those are like $2,000 for the pair, $1,000 for a single one. If anyone wants to get into a small diaphragm condenser for the studio, do you have any recommendations there?
I would start with the Rode NT5s. That's what I started with. Mm-hmm. It was just kind of like an easy decision.
Yeah.
It was what I could afford, so I did it.
And easy to mod later on if you want to step them up even a notch from there.
Yeah. I love the AKG mics, the 451s.
Oh, right.
They're much more expensive, but we had a lot of Avatar. I got used to using them, and I think AKG makes really solid microphones.
Cool, cool. Well, a couple things I wanted to comment on just on those last couple of clips. For people who are recording at home, I think two of the most common things are going to be voice and acoustic guitar. So do you have any pointers on recording either voice or acoustic guitar at home?
First thing you want to do is not be near any walls, not be near any mirrors, any glass. You know, maybe you can use some blankets or pillows. I know I've used like couch cushions. It looks like you're building a fort. It's kind of fun.
Something like the SE Electronics reflection filter, though, that we heard. Maybe a slightly simpler version of doing that.
Right. But I would start with just talking or making some kind of noise. You know, as we change the... As we put up the acoustic panels on the wall and took them down and compared the sound and used the reflection filter and didn't use the reflection filter, just talking or playing an instrument, you can hear the difference.
Right.
So, like, the biggest thing about recording at home is find a place, a chair, a couch, whatever, where you can actually play it and it sounds good in that location. So stay away from glass, stay away from corners.
You get a lot of bass buildup in a corner like that.
Right.
I think that's one of the things is people don't always think about, hey, if it sounds good here at this spot in the room, it may translate to a recording. And I think one of the other mistakes home recorders make is they don't put on headphones and listen to the difference in mic placements. And that's a big thing. You can't just look and say, mic looks like it's a good place.
Right.
You got to have that guitar, get some headphones on, hear how it sounds. If you're closer to the body, maybe you're getting more bass, more mid-range back by the bridge. If you're getting closer to the neck, you're getting more high-end. So that's a big thing.
Right.
For those of you who want to go into guitar mic techniques in more detail, we actually have a whole three-part guitar miking series right here on B&H's video channel. So check those out. We've got two parts of it on acoustic guitar miking and one part on electric guitar miking. All right, any final words of wisdom for recording vocals or voice in the home studio?
Try to make it sound good in the room. If you can focus on recording a good sound without throwing a bunch of EQ and compression and other plugins on it immediately, try to just listen to how it sounds naturally. How does it sound to you as an audience member? What is that instrument supposed to sound like? And then put a mic on it and try to capture that. When you listen to it back on the speakers, how similar does it sound to what it sounds like when the performer is playing it? Do you have the details? Do you have the nuance? Is it well balanced? I think if you're recording a guitar or a piano, you know, is the range that the performer is playing in, is that well balanced? Are you getting a good representation of lows to highs, both, you know, in the frequency range, but also just low notes to high notes? Are the mics in a position where you're like getting the full range?
Sure. And then one more question about doing vocal takes at home. Do you have any words of wisdom about recording vocals in a home studio?
First word of wisdom, get a six pack or some wine, give it to your neighbor.
Because
you're probably going to piss off your neighbor and you don't want them blasting their TV when you're trying to record. So, you know, make friends with your neighbors. After that, I try to find, you know, the place in my room where I can put a mic in front of some insulation, some kind of acoustic panel. You know, maybe I got to unplug the refrigerator for a little bit, or, you know, cool the room down with AC and then turn it off. To me, so much is about the actual performance. And so make sure that the singer is comfortable. You know, make sure their headphone mix is good. Make sure you have no click bleed if you're using click. I feel like so many things can just be approached from a technical standpoint, then take it from there. I think that, you know, it's easy to want to be creative from the get-go from the beginning and be sort of like artistic in the way that you approach things, which is important. But also, I think, like,
get avoiding the basics mistakes. Right. Yeah, no background noise, no click bleed, make sure they're comfortable. And most of the creativity, ideally, should come from the performer,
right,
even more than the recording.
Right.
That said, we like to get creative when it comes to recording. So I guess one thing I threw out there is it's always nice to have a singer try three mics if you have three mics on hand, because you might be surprised by the one they sound best on.
Right.
It could be the cheapest one. It could be the weird one you didn't expect to sound good.
Right.
Yeah. But even more important than that is make sure the refrigerator doesn't turn on in the middle of the take. Make sure the air conditioner isn't on.
Cell phones off.
Cell phones off. That's a big one. You don't have the neighbors with the broomstick.
Right.
And I like your idea about getting the neighbors a six pack. I thought you were going to say get the singers a six pack. That sounds good in theory, but can turn out
never
very
works.
Bad. All right, Bob, thanks so much for taking the time to talk to us about mic techniques for the home studio.
Justin, thank you.
Been great hanging out with you. This has been Justin Colletti of Sonic Scoop. We've been here at the home studios with Mr. Bob Mallory, thanks to B&H. Thanks for joining us for this three-part series on best practices for the home studio. This has been the part on mic techniques and mic lockers. Please make sure to check out the other two segments on acoustic treatment and monitoring for the home studio. Thanks again for hanging out with us. See you next time.